Hi, I'm Neil, and welcome to Dreaming of Chess Mastery, a YouTube channel that examines and reflects on the world of adult chess improvement. This week I thought I'd revisit my experiences with playgrandmasters.com, a fantastic website which I highly recommend, where you can select games and then guess the move. Solitaire chess, it's known in some circles. The game I looked at this morning, first game, was Botvinnik versus Smyslov from 1946. And I'll confess, I was all over the show. I guessed less than half the moves. And based on that percentage of correct guesses, the site gave me an ELO performance of 1622, which is a long way below my average level. I was a bit disappointed, I must admit. But I did get to thinking, if I'd played through the game, and this game has been selected from ones on the Garry Kasparov, my great predecessor's series, this is from volume 2, which I have, and I've looked at a lot of games in those books. And when I play through them, I think, yes, I follow the game. If I'd followed this one, studied it, read the annotations, I'm sure I would have got the feeling that I'd understood what I was reading. But playing through it in a more active way told a completely different story. Because in this guess the move game puzzle, obviously if you get a move wrong, you see the right move and you can think about it and you can pick up the idea of what the grandmaster is trying to do. And Botvinnik's games are masterpieces in terms of coherent strategy. I mean, that was what he was famous for. And this game certainly did make sense from start to finish. But whilst I got some moves right, I think on closer inspection I will find that the critical moves when decisions determining a transition in the game were made, I pretty much got all of those wrong. So in no way, shape or form can I claim to have understood the game. But if I'd played through it, I would have felt like I did, because it's a passive experience. You're nodding your head in agreement to, first of all, the moves of a famous world champion and the annotations and reflections given by arguably the greatest player of all time. So I think this emphasizes why this is a very, very good way of engaging with material. Particularly, I can now go and play through the game in Gary's book and see what he had to say about make of it. And that's a very much more positive interaction with the book. Now, I was feeling a bit disappointed after my experience with that game, so I thought, I need a bit of a pick-me-up. So I went for some low-hanging fruit, and I studied another game. This time it was a game from a Moscow-Prague chess match, maybe also in 1946. Zita Bronstein, a King's Indian defense, very, very famous. Because in that match tournament, Bronstein played pretty much the same idea and same combination on the black side of a King's Indian. First against Pachman and then against Zita. Lightning striking twice, so to speak. Now, I'm familiar with the games. Have I studied it in great depth? I think may have rushed through it, and I certainly know the combination. But I thought, I wonder how I will fare with the familiarity with the idea. And not surprisingly, I fared well. On this occasion, I guessed 80% of the moves. And I'm not saying that to boast, because obviously I knew what was coming. I had a good idea of the main positional theme. You know, black is going to sacrifice the exchange to gain control of the long diagonal running from h8 to a1. He's going to take advantage of the weakness on f2. I was very, very familiar with the game. The fact that I didn't guess all the moves showed that, I was familiar with it, but it wasn't something that I'd committed to memory. So at that point, I thought, well, what would happen if I played through it right now again? And actually, astoundingly, other than one transposition, which I played quickly and made a mistake playing the second move first, I got the game 100% almost, 99 point something percent correct. Wonderful. ELO performance of 3,200 and something. Well, of course, it isn't. It's, at that point, a test of memory. But that provoked, an interesting question. If I had studied chess enough to have committed enough of these positions and stratagems to memory, well, and enough, obviously, begs a question, how much is enough? But if I did do that over a period of years and an enormous number of hours of research, how would that translate into performance in actual games? You know, I have in my life never had a chance to play these beautiful sacrificial ideas of Bronstein's from this game. But, maybe they are precursors to understanding deeper ideas that might be more prevalent in modern chess. I'm not sure. The point is that the joint experience of these two games that I studied this morning suggested to me something very, very powerful, that we need to engage in chess material, obviously actively, and secondly, that even hapless amateurs such as myself can eventually, over a period of time, get to grips and understand, at least to a fair degree, the workings, the thought processes of these great players, at least to some extent. And if I can piece together enough of that, I think that's going to translate into a serious improvement. Of course, that begs, once again, the big question, how much is enough? And poses the frightening challenge, which is, what work will be required? Having gone over these games, I think I'm not finished with them. I need to record my thoughts. And in the case of the Zita Bronstein game, I need to try and codify that in the sense of the prion. As a standard sort of position, a standard kind of idea that I need to look for further examples and use it as a sort of leverage mechanism to unpack the position. But one thing is clear. I now have at my disposal material of much greater quality and interactive software that will allow me to learn from these classic masterpieces in a way that I never could 30 plus years ago. the first time I saw that go. And that's very exciting, because whether I become a stronger player or not in some sort of concrete rating sense really doesn't matter. This morning's activities, besides being providing me with an interesting insight into my own learning process, were a chance to really get a deeper insight into how one of chess's pioneering, truly great chess geniuses thought about the game. And of course, in the case of the Botvinnik match, it gave me a chance to realise that don't worry about trying to understand contemporary chess thought processes. Perhaps a good place to start is post-World War II and get some measure of understanding of what was going on with those masters. And perhaps that will be a necessary first step before trying to understand our modern game. Well, that's it for this week. I will end with a powerful endorsement of this website. I'll give you a link in the description below, because it really is an easy to use, wonderful way of studying classic games of chess, or for that matter, contemporary chess. So that's it for this week. As always, I trust you're well, you're enjoying your chess, your lives are filled with joy, and until next week, ciao from a sunny Brazil.